Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Political Excess. We've got some news here from Arizona Senate. Marc Victor, the Libertarian candidate, has dropped out and endorsed Republican challenger Blake Masters over Mark Kelly. It's a little bit late in the race, but I think that'll probably help Blake Masters just a little bit. Could be enough to put him over the top. Who knows? In this picture here, Blake Masters really looks like a giant over these two marks. Obviously, that doesn't really affect anything, but just throwing that out there. But today we're going to take a close look into one of these polls. Now this is from Siena College and the New York Times. And they polled the four key Senate races, Arizona, Pennsylvania, Georgia, and Nevada. I definitely agree those are the four where everything is up for grabs. And this shows some decent news for Democrats. Arizona, they're up 6 points, 51 to 45. Pennsylvania, six also. Georgia, they're up three, and it's even at 47 apiece in Nevada. Now, the Arizona poll is probably the best I've seen for Democrats this past week. As for the news about Blake Masters getting endorsed by the Libertarian candidate who's dropping out, I would say that'll help him maybe 1 to 2 points. If he's down by six, that wouldn't be enough. But in the other polls, he's only down by 2 to 3. That could be enough to give him the edge. Now, down below here, it does tell you the sample sizes in each state. Arizona had 604 likely voters. It tells you the dates that they took these polls. They basically took these polls from last week. The sample sizes are similar in all these states, except Nevada had 885 likely voters and was from a little bit farther back. But let's get on 538 and see how Siena College slash the New York Times upshot is rated. And that has an A-plus rating. 83 polls analyzed, 73% called correctly. I'm not sure how they defined correctly. It's probably just predicting the winner correctly, even if the margin is way off. But let's go down here and take a look at their accuracy. This is within 21 days of an election. The polls closer to the line, which is on the left side, those are the most accurate. All the way on the right side, those are the least accurate. And you could hover over any of these circles, and it will show you the race and the margin. So I guess their best one on here was 2018 in Iowa's 3rd Congressional District. They nailed it completely, 2.2 points for Cindy Axne. And their least accurate poll was in 2018, the Texas's 23rd Congressional District. They underestimated Will Hurd in that race by 15 points. Now, I get it. House races are harder to poll because there's so many of them. The sample sizes are usually smaller. There's just more room for error. But let's click on this tab, and it'll show you what direction the polls were biased. And there's some of them all over, obviously. Some did overestimate Republicans. Some did overestimate Democrats. So this does have an A-plus rating. I'm not sure if that's relative to the other pollsters or if that's independent. But when I hear A+, I would think that it would be very accurate very often. And just on a glance, this does not seem to be extremely accurate A+ material. Let's go down here and look at their 2020 poll results. And in Pennsylvania for president, they said Biden would win by 6. He won by 1.2. In Florida, they said Biden would win by 3. Trump won by 3.4. In Arizona, the U.S. Senate special election, they said Mark Kelly would win by 7. He won by 2.3. In Wisconsin for president, Biden would win by 11. He won by 0.6. Arizona for president, 6 points for Biden. He won by 0.3. North Carolina governor Roy Cooper would win by 9. He won by 4.5. And this goes on and on. All of these polls on a glance clearly did overestimate Democratic support. And not by 1 or 2 points. Most of these were at least 4 points. But I really don't understand why this has an A-plus rating. Looking at their most recent results, they're just too far skewed in favor of the Democrats. So we can look more into this New York Times poll. And at the top, it has the tabs for all four of these competitive states. I like that. And it will show you all the questions that were asked in this poll. So of course, it has all of your favorables and unfavorables for the statewide candidates. That's fine. And then this is from the top line number. If this November's election for U.S. Senate were held today, which candidate would you be more likely to vote for? Mark Kelly, the Democrat, gets 51% of the vote. Blake Masters, the Republican, gets 45%. Marc Victor, that Libertarian, gets 1%. 3% don't know or refused. Now, down under this question, this is what I believe they asked before this question. This is without leaners. And Mark Kelly goes down to 49% there. Blake Masters stays at 45%. And then down below that, this asks, if you had to decide, would you lean toward 30% of those, say, Mark Kelly? 11 say Blake Masters, 11 say Marc Victor the Libertarian, and another 49% of those undecideds still say they don't know or refused. Now the thing that does not make a lot of sense to me is right down here, this asks, what is your preference for the outcome of this year's Senate elections? Based on those previous results, I would think it would line up exactly, maybe be off by a point or so. But this is not close at all. This says preference for the Senate would be Democratic control at 42% and Republican control at 49%. I don't understand why 51% of voters would say they would vote for Mark Kelly, but 49% would prefer Republican control of the Senate? Something is off there, and I'm never going to know what it is. But that is a 13-point swing when asking between Mark Kelly and Blake Masters who you would vote for. Now down below here, it will ask about educational level. It'll ask if you're Democrat, Republican, or Independent. This says their sample is 29% Democrat, 33% Republican, 32% Independent. But then it also has 50% voted for Donald Trump last time, only 44% for Joe Biden. That to me is not representative of that electorate. And then down below here, it does say 604 likely voters, plus or minus 4.4% for the margin of error. 87% were reached on a cellular telephone. 2% were conducted in Spanish. I like that they add that. But then down below, it goes into their methodology for the sample and for weighting. And when it comes to weighting, technically all pollsters can make whatever adjustments they want if they think it's going to match up with the expected electorate. So that's another reason why it's good to look at things in the aggregate, get 2, 3, 4 different polls before you make any judgments. So again, take a look at these other states if you'd like, Georgia, Nevada, and Pennsylvania. Now back up at the top here, it has crosstabs available, so we can click on this and take a look at those. And this is great, it'll give you a ton of data on all of these questions, but it'll break it down by gender, age, race, education, 2020 vote, party ID, party registration. And for example, this first question asks how likely you are to vote in this upcoming midterm. But this sample size is supposed to be already from likely voters, so I'm not sure exactly how that works. But this shows us that the 65 plus demographic is actually the least likely to say they're almost certain to vote. That is surprising, as that group is usually very likely to vote in most of these elections. So I'm not sure what that's about. But let's go down to the question about voting for Mark Kelly or Blake Masters. Obviously, there's an expected gender gap there. Male voters are 12% more likely to go for Blake Masters. Female voters are 22% more likely to vote for Mark Kelly. 18 to 29 goes overwhelming for Mark Kelly at 68%. 30 to 44 is at 56% for Kelly. And then it flips to Blake Masters, 50% of 45 to 64-year-olds, and 52% of 65 and up. The racial breakdown shows Blake Masters getting 50% of the white vote versus 48% for Mark Kelly. I would think that would be more so in favorable of Blake Masters for the white demographic. Only a 2-point margin seems a little low to me. Kelly's getting 66% of the Hispanic vote, 58% of the non-white vote. For education, Mark Kelly is getting 55% of the bachelor's and up crowd versus 43% for Blake Masters. The non-college graduate group is going 49% for Mark Kelly, 47% for Blake Masters. I would expect that to also be flipped. Maybe these candidates in this election are defying some expectations, but so far I do have some questions about how accurate this poll is going to be in the end. With the 2020 vote, Blake Masters is getting 3% of those Biden voters. Mark Kelly is getting 10% of those Trump voters. And the all-important independents are going 60% for Mark Kelly, 35% for Blake Masters. So you can go on and on and on looking through all these questions and all the different polls, all the different crosstabs. Sometimes you'll be able to paint a clearer picture of how much confidence you'll have in a particular poll. Other times you're going to find conflicting data points and it's not going to make a lot of sense. There's already some things within this poll that I've found that I don't think really make total sense. It's possible they could on election day, but I think we're going to be in for some surprises. And this has an A+ rating again on 538. But looking back at the previous accuracy, it does not seem to be really all that spectacular in my opinion. Anyway, I will leave it there for now. You can look through all these polls, any other polls, all the different states. I encourage it. It can be time consuming. It can be tedious. I understand it's not for everybody. That's why I don't want to go too far into it on this video. But let me know in the comments down below, what do you make of these polls? Do you think they're accurate? Do you think they're going to be off? And if you enjoy this channel, please like, share, and subscribe. Thank you for watching. And I'll see you next time.